And welcome to Immaculate Conception Church. Please mute all mobile devices. Today we celebrate Mass for the 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time, and this Mass is being said for Father Thomas Cunnell. This is coins for Social Justice Weekend. All loose change in the collection will be earmarked for social justice concerns. Our opening hymn is number 742, The Church's One Foundation, and we'll do verses 1 and 2. Please stand.
Forgive us our sins, your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
He knows.
Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi and asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said in reply, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus said to him in reply, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly ordered his disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
There's a phrase that comes from the Flying Dutchman. It says, "The Dutchman must always have a captain." Now, I don't know all the ins and outs of the movie and why that has to be the case, but when I saw it, it stuck with me. It reminds me a lot of the office of the Pope. He is the head. He's the captain of the ship of the church, and the church will always have a captain. Its name will be the Pope. And our readings teach clearly of the office of the Pope, and we see the importance carried out through history. So in particular, we see Jesus actually establish an office. It begins in Isaiah. So in this little section from Isaiah, we hear God talking to Shebna. Now Shebna, if you don't remember him, he was the royal steward of the palace. And that's an office established by King Solomon himself. So that means that this position will be always with the king. Someone will always be the royal steward. And the steward, he's the second in command in the entire kingdom. So the royal steward controlled access to the king. He would literally unlock or lock that door so people could go be with the king. But Shebna forgot his place. Shebna confused his high position that, oh yeah, he's just as good as the king himself. Shebna was even having a tomb made for himself, which is reserved only for kings. So God, in our reading, in the first reading, he's literally just stepping in and says, "Yeah, you're out, Shebna. I'm transferring this office to Eliakim. In fact, I'm actually going to give Eliakim more power in the house of David. So that when Eliakim opens and shuts the door, no one will open or shut it." And Jesus takes this well-known image in the imagination of the Jews, and now he's extending it to Peter in a unique way. So Jesus, they're in Caesarea Philippi, and he's with his disciples. And he says, "Well, who do people say that I am?" Then he asks his disciples, "Well, who do you say that I am?" We could spend a whole homily on this. Jesus asks us daily, who do we say that he is? And our actions answer. But to resume the institution of the office of the Pope. So Peter steps out and he responds, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And now Jesus does something quite awesome. Jesus is investing Peter with the role of the royal steward. The kingdom that Jesus is establishing. Jesus and the disciples clearly have the same passage from Isaiah in their mind. Just like God the Father instituted the role of the royal steward, so too God the Son is establishing the role of a royal steward in this kingdom that he is building here on earth that extends into heaven. As Jesus does so, we see a dramatic change in Peter. Because the same weak, impulsive Peter of the Gospels becomes the courageous and strong defender of the Gospel after Pentecost. And this shows us three important things regarding the office of the Pope: love, unity, and shepherding. So Jesus establishes the office of the Pope that will continue until the end of time, first, for love. Jesus wants us to love him. We can only love what we know. Jesus wanted to make sure that we could know him maximally so that we can love him maximally as well. That's why the Pope, by virtue of his office, has a special charism called infallibility. So the man himself in the role of Pope may not be a saint. In fact, we've had plenty of scandalous popes in our 2,000 years. But there's something that they all have in common. They've all been preserved from changing our teaching, because truth will never change. Jesus gave the Pope a special grace so that the Pope cannot be wrong on faith and morals. So he may be a morally decrepit leader, he may be a saint, he may be whomever, but Jesus made sure that the Pope can never change the teaching. Why? Because Jesus established the church so that we might love him. We love him by knowing him. Therefore, Jesus had to make sure that we can know him authentically without any error. The second reason why Jesus established the office of the Pope is for unity. Just like the Dutchman will always have a captain, so too the church will always have a pope. But this comes with a price. If you look at about the first 300 years, that's a long time, the first 35 popes were all saints. Many of them were killed. Why? Because if you want to get rid of a group, you go after the leader. Just like Jesus himself, when the authorities wanted to get rid of Jesus and all of his teachings, they get rid of Jesus. But we're still here. We're still united around one leader. It's an incredible gift that all Catholics throughout the world, in theory, believe the same dogmas, have the same sacraments, and are all united in one leader, the Pope. Jesus established one church, one baptism, one family for the entire world. A third reason why Jesus established the office of the Pope is because he continues to shepherd his people through this church. That's something we might not think about that much in our time. But it's not just that Jesus got out of the cross, he sent him to heaven and says, "All right, guys, figure it out on your own, I'll see you at the end." That's not the kind of God that we have. That'd be weird. So Jesus continues to speak to us through his church. Jesus did not decide all matters of the application of divine law itself, nor did he write down a book with all of the possible answers to all the controversies that might ever arise in the history of the church. He did, however, establish his royal steward, his right-hand man, in the office of the Pope to continue guiding his ship, the church, and those gathered in it safely into heaven. So it's a bit of a teaching homily, but sometimes we don't appreciate what we have as Catholics. The office of the Pope is a great gift because by it, we can love Jesus more, be united, and experience Jesus' shepherding until the end of time. We may not always like the Pope, but when we find ourselves in those moments, we must remember to put our trust in Jesus' promise, not in the man in the office. Jesus promised that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. So he gave us a captain to guide us through the storms. Even when it looks otherwise, we must trust Jesus and pray that his royal steward, the Pope, will be faithful to his office and guide us safely to heaven. I believe in one God, the Father and the Holy Spirit. trusting in our Father's love for us, we present to him these our needs.
For our Holy Father, that his faith in the inner support of the Heavenly Father may be his strength, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
those who accept or attain the burden of public office, that the powers of evil may not prevail over them, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
that we may be challenged by the question of Jesus, who do you say that I am? And that our answer may determine our thoughts, words, and action. We pray to the Lord. For those living with disabilities, that they may not be pushed aside, overlooked, or underestimated, we pray to the Lord. For all I see parishioners, that we may reverence the power of the keys which God entrusts to the pastors of his church, we pray to the Lord. Father Thomas Pennell, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are ill, especially Bev Atkinson, all those on our prayer chain and our books of intention, may they be touched by the healing power of Jesus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Victoria Barbie, Francis Mosicki, our loved ones and all who have died as a result of violence, may they rejoice with the Lord in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Heavenly Father, please answer all of these prayers according to your will, for we make them all through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you lay the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." With your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, your spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope and Herder, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your honor. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at the passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Number 742, and we'll do verses 3 and 4.